Oh, hey guys. Just practicing. Got a lot of time on my hands here lately, so I'm trying a few different things. It's not coming along real well, but maybe soon we'll be playing something for you. But I do have something for you today. John chapter 13. John chapter 13 is bookended by two passages, two statements from that are compelling us how to live, looking at how Christ lived and how we are to live. In John 13, 1, it says, "Before the feast of the Passover, when Jesus knew that his hour had come to depart out of this world to the Father, having loved his own who were in the world, he loved them to the end." And this is an emphasis in John chapter 13, 1, that is beginning to drive us through the remainder of the book of John, which is going to focus on the Passion Week, the final week of the life of Christ. And so here it is saying that Jesus is loving his own. He is getting ready to go to the cross. The cross is about following the will of the Father to redeem humanity. And it says up until the point, he is still serving and loving his own, the disciples. Then at the end of John chapter 13, in verses 34 through 35, Jesus tells his disciples, he says to love one another. He says, love one another just as I have loved you. You also are to love one another. Well, this is what bookends John chapter 13. Let's take a look at what's in the middle. John chapter 13 is recording the account of when Jesus washes the feet of the disciples. This is right before the Last Supper. Actually, during it, it says, during the supper, Jesus gets up. The way this would have happened is the upper room would have been prepared, ready for them to celebrate this meal. And as they go in, there is a basin. There is a bowl there to wash your feet. And this is a typical thing that's done in their day. It's a way that when you enter into a home, you would wash your feet and then prepare for the meal. But as they walk in, none of the disciples offer to wash the feet of anyone else or to wash their own feet. This would have been a task for the lowest of the servants. And so they all pass by. And we understand that when the disciples are walking on the road and conversing with one another, one of the things they're struggling with is who's the greatest, not who's the least. The least is the one who would stoop down to wash the feet. And so nobody's going to do that or volunteer to do that. And so they are startled when they see Jesus get up. It says he wraps himself. So essentially just imagine, best way to understand this is kind of like getting a towel, getting ready. And he sits down and he starts to wash their feet. And they're stunned. And Peter is specifically says, he's like, you shall never wash my feet. You're not going to demonstrate that kind of humility. You're not going to portray yourself as that kind of a servant. No, that's beneath you, Jesus. And Jesus demonstrates to Peter that there's no task that's beneath him. I think there's three things. Well, maybe more than three, but three things I want to highlight out of this foot washing that Jesus is demonstrating to us. And first, we'll start with one that's obvious that we focus most on, is that Jesus is doing this to serve them. In verse 12 and following, it says, after Jesus did this, he says, do you understand what I've done for you? He says, you call me teacher and Lord, and you are right, for so I am. If I, then your Lord and teacher, have washed your feet, you also ought to wash the feet of one another. And so Jesus is demonstrating the heart of service we're to have for one another, that we should not look at any task as being beneath us. There's nothing that is beneath us. We serve one another as God calls us to serve, we serve. There's no task that is a sub-task, something that's below or beneath. Jesus would wash their feet. He would serve. And so, take out the trash. Do your chores. These are things that we're called to do. And it is nothing that is beneath us. We are to serve one another. It's how we demonstrate that we have love for one another, that we serve one another. So that's the first thing. But there's a couple other things that we cannot miss. Because this is what Jesus, I think, one of the biggest things he's trying to portray is this. The foot washing is actually communicating to us something about the cross. It is speaking to us about what Jesus is about to do. He's washing, and then when Peter, remember, he says, you shall never wash my feet. But then Jesus says, if I do not wash you, you have no share with me. Now, that's kind of a strange thing to say if he's only focusing on the act of foot washing. Jesus is trying to communicate something. Remember, we see this and we've emphasized this. I'm going to continue to emphasize this because it's something we've got to grasp, that when we read the Gospels and we read the accounts of Jesus's teachings and the parables and the things, we understand that very, very, very often, if not all the time, there's more than what's just on the surface. Jesus is showing that he's going to cleanse them, to wash them, to what? To remove our sin. And he's saying that if we have to have our sin removed from us, if we're to be apart with him, he is going to do the work. It also shows, that's the second thing. A third one is when he talks about, he says, the one who is bathed does not need to wash except for his feet. I think in this one, Jesus is alluding to this, is that when we put our faith in Christ, we are fully cleansed and fully his. But yet, we do need to daily come to him. We need to, on a regular basis, come to him. Just like the foot washing was a regular thing, we come to him. We come to him to be in that right relationship with him. Well, that was the foot washing. Then it leads into this other thing. Well, I just want to touch on, because we're going to spend a little bit more time on this in the future. But Jesus tells the disciples that he's greatly troubled in spirit because one of them is going to betray him. One of them is going to betray him. And this one, we would know, ultimately, would be Judas Iscariot. Jesus even reveals that here to the disciple who leans over to speak to him. But when Jesus tells Judas to go and do what he's going to do quickly, they didn't get it. They didn't quite understand because a veil was yet over their eyes. And Jesus was going to remove that veil soon. And all things were going to be revealed to them very, very soon. Well, hey, tomorrow we're going to be in John chapter 14. Actually, Monday we'll be in John chapter 14, so I'll see you then.